On today's show,
it's just one game, but Sean Livingston is the real MVP, and the Cavs look like they're in a whole lot of trouble.
Lee Ellis joins us live from G State to tell us why he's wearing those sunglasses and why the Oracle was quieter than normal during game one.
And the Aussie quizzes people outside the arena to see if they're true Warriors fans or just bandwagon jumpers.
It's Friday, June 3rd. The starter starts now.
Good evening, Sweet World, and welcome to the Starters. Shout out to everyone joining us live right now on NBA TV or even a little bit later on YouTube. We're happy to have all of you. I'm J.E. Skeets, and alongside me, as always, that's Tass Mellis.
You know what they say, a playoff series doesn't start until someone's hit in the groin.
That's right. And over there, Starters blog editor, Trey Kirby.
Hey-o!
Hey-o! TK, what's up, man?
Guys, I'm here at the internet looking for your best tweet at hashtag the Starters, and Anderson Varejao got some hilarious revenge on his former team last night, and it wasn't just the big Warriors win. Andy also drew two charges on the Cavs, giving them a taste of that sweet, sweet flopping that they enjoyed for so many years. The first was so egregious that not only was Kevin Love telling Ed Malloy it was a flop, LeBron James also got in on the action, as we learned from The Vertical's Chris Mannix, who tweeted that LeBron got in the ref's ear and said, "That's a flop. I know him, and that's a flop." Now, LeBron played 7.5 seasons with Varejao, so the guy knows what he's talking about. And it brings us to today's question. What do you know about the finals based solely on a player's past? For instance, you know, if the Warriors start tripping and it seems like there's no reason, the reason is probably because J.R. Smith started untying everybody's shoelaces. The guy spent $50,000 in fines in one season to untie 3 pairs of shoelaces, and if you love something that much, odds are you're gonna get back in the game at some point. But we wanna hear from you. Let us know on Twitter, what do you know about the finals based on a player's past? Send us your best answers at hashtag the starters, and we'll hear from you a little bit later.
All right, get your tweets in, guys. A little bit later on the show, we will talk to Lee Ellis live in Oakland. He looks like the Terminator tonight, so that'll be fun. You'll want to stick around for that. We got a little fun from Lee Ellis as well. He actually quizzes some Warriors fans. We try and separate the pretenders from the contenders when it comes to Warriors fans.
I'm glad Lee's not here to see that untying clip from J.R. Smith.
It gets him angry.
He finds it so unsafe when guys do that.
You're absolutely right. All right, well, let's talk about game one, because that was an interesting game one, to say the least. On a night when the Splash Brothers, Steph Curry and Klay Thompson, came up dry, it was backup point guard Sean Livingston scoring himself the podium game. He dropped 20 points off the bench to lead the Warriors to the 104-89 Game 1 victory of the NBA Finals. So with Game 1 officially in the books, feels like the perfect time to totally overreact by playing It's Just One Game, But. Trey, make them mountains out of molehill.
Sounds great. It's just one game, but with the Warriors winning easily, with Klay and Steph not lighting things up, it's safe to say this series is over, ladies and gentlemen. It's over.
It's time for some hot takes. It's way over. No, I'm not going to go that far. Listen, the Cavs are the underdog.
Yeah.
And their chances have been decreased even more so because they gave away a game to the bench, basically, and the role players for the Golden State Warriors. You know Steph and Klay are going to find their groove at some point. They combined for 20 points. It feels like they know how to find the holes in the defenses and will figure out what the Cavs give them. That being said, I don't think the Cavs change anything really defensively. I think they're more worried about the offensive end. I think they look at the bench and they say, Sean Livingston, you went off, fine. Leandro Barbosa, you went off, fine. We're going to have to live with that for now if you guys are going to get hot. I think they might take Kevin Love out of that five spot because guys looked a little comfortable going to the rim when Kevin Love was the five. But Livingston shooting 80%, Barbosa shooting 100%. Bogut 71%. I think they kind of live with that and see what happens with Steph and Klay and try and figure out the other end.
Yeah, the offense, though, is going to be the problem. I mean, I know you're having some fun there with the it's just one game, but the series is over there, Trey. But to some extent, it sort of is. And that's why I had the Warriors winning this in five. No, I'm serious. I do still think the Warriors take care of game two. They're not going to let what happened last year. I think they learn from that.
That's
big. I think they get game two, and then we find out what happens in Cleveland. It's a whole different series, of course. But, I mean, you said it all there. The bench beat them. And that was a game for the taking. They didn't play well because the problem is I don't think the Cavs can score enough in this series. It's one thing to play the Hawks and the Pistons and the Raptors. It's another to play one of the best defenses we've seen in the league. And that's what the Warriors are. They switch on absolutely everything. They didn't get a whole lot of three-point attempts up, the Cavs. I mean, they came into this finals averaging 14 three-pointers made per game. They were the best offense in the postseason coming in the finals. And then they ran into this Golden State defense that just completely smothered them. And I think we're going to continue to see it. Now, I will say, the Cavs are going to score better in the restricted area. Like, they went 18 of 38, by the paint there, right by the rim. That's going to get better, but I don't still think they're going to be able to put up enough points because we know Curry and Klay will get it going, and they can score 100 in their sleep. Can the Cavs do it? And look, we show you there. It's a good start. You win a game by 15-plus points in game one of the finals, you tend to go on to win the title. So a great start from the Cavs, but lots of basketball still.
No disrespect to the Toronto Raptors, the Hawks, and the Detroit Pistons, but the Cavs were just shocked in this first game.
Sure.
I mean, they hadn't faced adversity whatsoever so far. Everybody looked a little bit shaky to start. They're not going to turn the ball over like 15 times in that manner. They just didn't realize some guys were trailing them, like LeBron with 3 minutes left. Draymond Green's trailing him. He's got to realize that. They just weren't ready. And listen, they were up late in the third quarter, and we'll talk about that with LeBron James sitting on the bench and where that lead went.
All right, Trey, next one, next overreaction.
Well, speaking of that, Tass, the Warriors went on a nice run with LeBron James on the bench, so it's just one game, but LeBron's got to play 48 minutes a game from here on out.
No, he doesn't. He doesn't. I'm annoyed by this. I'm a little bit annoyed by this.
I thought they're the underdog. They're not going to win.
Because, no, these are the headlines we see today, all right? This might be the most balanced team LeBron has ever been on, but the Cavs will only go as far as he can take them against the Warriors. Well, which one is it? LeBron, okay, he didn't have the greatest game ever. I agree with that. But he got help from no one. Kyrie went to ISO Kyrie. Kevin Love struggled to score inside, and nobody else gave him absolutely anything. So the answer isn't to play LeBron for full 48 minutes. Yeah, they went on a great run, but that's not going to help. I mean, LeBron's being asked to do a lot already. And by the way, he now has his guys there. They're the ones that got to support him, both offensively and defensively. So I don't really buy this.
No, I think he can't play 48 minutes physically. He can't lead the team for an entire game. We just saw what happened at the end of the third quarter there. He went to the bench with 34 seconds left. They were down 3 points. When he came back, they were down 14 points because they played a lot of isolation ball, like you mentioned, about Kyrie Irving. They got to play a little bit more team ball against a defense like the Golden State Warriors. The Warriors can't focus on one guy on one side of the floor.
Right.
And that's it. I mean, the ball has to move a little bit more. So LeBron went to the bench, and he was extremely upset with what he watched. I think they write that a little bit. I'm not saying that the Cavs are going to win this by any means, but we knew coming in, Steph Curry's got a better supporting cast. Steph Curry's got a team, every single guy on that roster, that went through the thick and the thin of the finals. Kyrie didn't have to do that. Kevin Love didn't have to do that.
Right.
J.R. Smith didn't come out and play like J.R. Smith in game one here. This was their adversity. Game two is big. I do agree with you, though. The Warriors won't let it slip like they did last year.
No, I don't think so. But look, LeBron is going to have better games in this series. Yeah. I mean, as great as the defense is from the Warriors, Iguodala and all those guys, and Draymond Green was matched up on him, he shut him down at times. LeBron's going to go better than 9 of 21. He had the 4 turnovers. He only got to the line 4 times as well. That's all going to increase at times in this series. But
they just got to move a little bit quicker, and LeBron's got to face up a little bit more. I think the ball moves a little bit more when he's looking at the rim rather than back to the basket.
Trey, next one.
All right, with Dele and Draymond flailing around out there, it's just one game, but somebody's going to get suspended this series.
No way. Do you see how Andre Iguodala handled that? Like a champ.
He grabbed his junk for
a
minute.
Because he got hit in it. Of course, he's going to caress it for a second. But listen, Iguodala, after the game, when asked about this situation, he said, "I respect a lot of guys' hustles in this league. You got guys who got to get dirty, got to get physical to make a life and to feed their families, and I respect that." That's how he handled getting hit below the belt. Because, like Steve Kerr called him, he is the adult in the room.
Yeah.
These guys are not going to lose their cool whatsoever. At all. The other side? Possibly. The Cavs might lose their cool, and I think that's what LeBron was upset with a little bit when he went to the bench. As soon as he went to the bench, that happened simultaneously. I think he wants his team to emulate the Spurs a little bit. Don't get under the other team's skins. It only riles them up, and that was the catalyst for that 11-0 run.
Yeah, that's absolutely right. I agree with that. I think we only maybe see a suspension, of course, whatever happens with Draymond because of his points, flagrant points, and tech points. But also, if, let's say, this series does get out of hand and the Warriors are suddenly up big in Game 3, let's say they're up 2-0, they go back to Cleveland, they get a big lead, then you sometimes see someone come in there and lay someone out, and that could be enough for a suspension. That could be in play. Trey, I think we got time for one more. What do you got?
I saw him destroy a clipboard with a single blow, so it's just one game, but I'm pretty sure Steve Kerr is the new Hulk.
I agree.
How did he do that? That was pretty crazy. It looks like a brittle board.
Yeah.
Or he's super strong. Which one is it?
This doesn't look real.
Bang!
It broke in half.
That thing shatters.
Yeah, on the drop this morning, I compared it to him like killing a White Walker in Game of Thrones.
Yeah, it's just Dragonstone.
Shattered everywhere, yeah. Maybe that marker is made out of Valyrian steel or something, we don't know. But yeah, I don't know. It's he's done this before, too. He's got a little history of killing clipboards. And it usually works, though. It gets his team fired up. It worked against the Knicks earlier in the year, and it worked again. I want to know, though, how hard that was. I think we have a clipboard behind you, Trey.
Oh, we do.
If you want to give it a go, if you want to Hulk out here. All right. Okay, hold on. Your team just gave away a huge lead.
Yeah.
Tristan Thompson just
Come on, guys!
Yeah, here we go.
Oh! Clean.
Did
it's clean.
Break?
No.
My arm, my wrist may have broken. You want to give it a shot?
I don't know why you tried that.
All right,
I'm not
give
trying
it.
That.
Come on, Trey. Oh, come, yeah. Oh.
That's a clipboard. It's not going to break.
Come on, one more. Kick it.
Yeah. Here. Hold that up. Hold it up and I'll kick it. Whoa, okay.
Steve Kerr's the Hulk.
Yeah, Steve Kerr's the Hulk. We got to take a break. When we come back, we'll get a Band-Aid for Trey, and we'll talk to the Aussie, Lee Ellis, live from Oakland. Look at this guy! There he is, Lee Ellis, live in the Bay. Woo! Whoa, first question, what are those?
It's a little bright and sunny out here, guys. I didn't bring my sunglasses, I should have, so I had to borrow these.
The future is so bright, he's got to wear shades. Lee, thanks for joining us.
California's got to you, man.
Yeah, is the pool nice?
Yeah, I had to actually just put my mojito to the side here to do this shot, but I'm all right now.
This guy is definitely on vacation. I mean, he's pretending to cover the finals. All right, Lee, first things first. We got a lot of questions here for you. First things first, though. We gave you a challenge yesterday to see if you could hit the Steph Curry tunnel shot. Have you had any success? Have you had a crack at it? And did you knock it down, big guy?
Well, I haven't had a chance yet, but after I do this hit with you guys, I am going to go and give it a try. There's all this media stuff out there right now. I got scooped by LeBron. I couldn't go out there and do it. So I have to wait until he's finished his media obligations, and then I'll get a chance to do it. So I'm looking forward to it. I think I feel good. I think I'm going to knock it in.
Are you going to wear your shades when you do it?
I might have to. I hadn't considered it until I came outside, but maybe I will.
Okay.
Maybe I will. I do have a little surprise for you when I do it, though. You have to wait and see.
Okay. Well, Ooh. We can't wait. All right. You were at game one last night where the Warriors pick up the big win over the Cavs. What was the arena like for this game one of the NBA Finals? I'd expect it was amazingly loud, but you tell us. You were there.
Yeah, it was really loud off the top. Everyone was obviously very excited. It was game one, and everyone was feeling pretty good about themselves. But the funny thing was, the way the game was actually played and won by the Warriors, it wasn't a traditional victory as far as Klay and Steph raining in bombs all day and you know, going for 30 or 40 points or anything like that. It was more a workmanlike performance. They got such a great contribution from their bench, and Sean Livingston and Andrew Bogut and all those guys sort of contributed. So it was actually, to be honest, a little sort of flatter than I was expecting, because the fans were happy, obviously, to get the win, but usually you see Steph at some point going on a bit of a run where he hits three or four threes, and then Klay does the same thing, but those guys only combined for 20 points. So I think the fans, you know, they'll obviously take the win, but it wasn't quite the usual way that the Warriors go about business.
You mentioned Sean Livingston. We know you like to delve deep into the techniques of shooters and how they release the ball. Watching him, I thought of you, and I thought you might not like the way Sean Livingston gets way up and releases the ball. Tell me what you think of Sean's form.
Well, it was very effective last night. I mean, he's obviously a long guy, and he's got those long arms, which makes it very, very hard to defend. And I think a good thing about him is he stays in his lane. He realizes what he can do and what he can't do. He's not a great three-point shooter, so he rarely takes one of those. But instead, he takes advantage of the mismatch that he creates often, because he's viewed as a guard, I guess, and often gets matched up with a smaller guy. So he just sort of can take them into the post or into the lane and rise up and just sort of go for a dinker and dumper, Tassie, which is right up your alleyway there. So
yeah, I thought, yeah. He's got bad form just like me. No, I'm just kidding. He's got good form.
But a veteran like him, I mean, that's what you want on a night when Klay and Steph weren't really, you know, having a great night themselves. Someone like him comes in, and he's had a bit of an up-and-down playoff series as well. So last night, I thought it was just a really good, solid performance from him, and he got a podium game out of it, so he was great.
Unbelievable game from Sean Livingston. We had a weird incident, though, in game one, Lee. It involved another Australian. It was Matthew Dellavedova punching Andre Iguodala in the Hibberts. in the groin. Now, it was just ruled a common foul after they looked at it. I'm curious, though, the media out there, because you're Australian, giving you a hard time with this incident from Delhi?
Well, not so much the media, but more my NBA TV colleagues here, because at this point, I was actually back in the green room watching it. And as soon as that happened, everyone just starts going, oh, that's the Australian way, isn't it, Lee? That's how they do it down under. He's not playing rugby out there, you know? And I'm like, I'm not actually responsible for every single other Australian's actions out on the court. But yeah, so I had to try to leave then and go off by myself for a while. But look, it was unfortunate. Delhi was just trying to stop the clock. So, you know, it was... you know, the interesting thing was today, though, actually, at Andre Iguodala's scrum, the very first question he was asked was how his crown jewels were. So he responded, he said they were fine. And then he got a follow-up question about it as well. A guy said, are you sure? And Iggy kind of looked at him and said, yeah, I'm fine. So okay. There's a scoop for you. Iggy will be playing in game two. He's not a game-time decision.
That's why we send you there for that hard-hitting report. Lee, thank you so much. I know we got a fun little video from you that you filmed before game one coming up after the break. Lee Ellis, oh man, shades and everything. We gotta take a break, but when we come back, Lee does separate the pretenders from the contenders when it comes to Golden State Warriors fans. Come on back, you're gonna wanna see this. Welcome back to the Starters. We asked you earlier in the show, what is something you know about the finals based on a player's past? You've hit us up on Twitter, hashtag the starters. Trey, you got a few of the best answers from the peeps.
Yeah, first one comes from Branko, who says he knows that Andre Iguodala is going to be dancing when someone travels. Do the Iguodala?
Do the Iguodala?
Perhaps? I don't know. Kevin says he knows not to reach on Uncle Drew. Hashtag don't reach, young blood.
Nice.
But the saddest and best answer comes from Jake, who said he knows players who wear Cleveland uniforms will not be holding the championship trophy post-series. That's from a Cavs fan.
Wow.
Straight emoji face.
Wow.
Sorry, Jake.
All right, anytime a team wins, there are fans that jump on that bandwagon, pretend they've been there forever. But Lee Ellis doesn't like those fans. No, he wants fans that have been there through the thick and the thin. So that's why he took to the streets of the Bay Area to quiz fans to determine whether or not they're true Warriors followers or just a bunch of Johnny-come-latelys.
I am joined by
Bethlon Coon.
You a big Warriors fan?
Always, yeah, man. Ever since I was a little kid back in the Baron Davis days.
Well, I'm going to test out just how big a fan you are. Okay. I got a few questions for you.
Okay, okay.
Okay, if you get them right, you're a champ. If you get them wrong, you have to give me your ticket, okay?
All right, all right. Oh, come on, man. Don't do that to me. It's the only ticket I got.
Okay, you're a big Warriors fan?
Oh, definitely, man. I'm such a big Warrior fan, I made a song about him. You want to hear it?
Let's hear it.
Steffi Curry, Steffi Curry, he's driving me crazy. Steffi Curry, Steffi Curry, Steffi Curry and the Warriors.
I am the owner and the builder of this championship basketball belt. It's only for heavyweights, and the Warriors is a heavyweight.
Wow, what an exciting moment this is.
What up, Skeets? Taz Mellis. What's up, y'all? Boys to men as well.
Oh, Robbie James of the Tweet of the Week Army.
Oh, wow, we've got a Tweet of the Week Army member.
Yeah.
Don't let the Tweet of the Week Army down. The captain will kick you out. First question. What is Steph Curry's first name?
Stephen Curry. But better known as Steph Curry.
Okay, 0 for 1.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness. Oh, that's it. I can't answer.
The first one's an easy one. What is Steph Curry's first name?
Stephen.
It's actually his middle name.
Really? What's his first name?
Wardell.
Well done.
You knew. Yeah, you knew that.
Stephen.
It's actually his middle name.
Really?
In the 90s, there was a famous trio called Run TMC. Can you name those three players?
Absolutely not.
Wow. And you won again.
TMC, I'm going to go in order. Tim Hardaway, Mitch Richmond, and Chris Mullin.
It is Run, Jam Master J, and also it was...
I'm not talking about Run DMC, I'm talking about Run TMC.
Oh!
Chris Mullin, Tim Hardaway, and Mitch Richmond.
He did it. Took him a while, but he got there. Who was the tallest player ever in Warriors history?
Oh, the 7'6" guy, Manute Bol.
Well done, you got it.
was it? I don't know.
I don't remember his name, but he's a foreigner.
That's right. He's from Sudan.
Yes, yes. I do not remember his name.
Manute Bol.
Manute Bol. Yes, yes. I'm Nigerian, so I should know that. Okay. All right. I get half a point.
All right. We'll give you half a point. Why not? Why not? Who is the tallest player ever in Warriors history?
Manute Bol.
You're killing it, man. You're killing it.
Check mark.
This kid can shoot the ball from anywhere. I mean it. He can shoot it from your tail.
Who was the last player to lead the Warriors team in scoring that was not Stephen Curry?
Ellis.
Monte Ellis, Ellis. You got it. Right. You got
That's
it.
Right.
You got it.
It took a little long, so I'm 56, so give me a break.
I would have to say Monte Ellis.
Oh, he's 4 for 4. Monte Ellis.
Monte Ellis.
Well done, well done.
I got it.
Who is the Warriors' all-time leading scorer?
Steph Curry.
Well, that's a clean sweep anyway, 0 for 5, but that's not too bad.
I'm a new Warrior fan, I guess.
All-time leading scorer's gotta be... Wilt Chamberlain.
5 for 5. What can you say?
Yeah, Dub Nation. I'm living that Dub life all day, every day.
He's an old guy, this guy.
I don't know.
Wilt Chamberlain.
What am I doing here?
Oh, man. That's Steph Curry rap.
Catchy.
That was fire.
I think Fat Joe was in the background there.
Great stuff from Lee Ellis and the Warriors fans out in the Bay. One more break. When we come back, a very solid play.
Back with the starters, Trey once again filling in for Lee with the very solid play. I hope we get an Australian accent this time.
Well, the Warriors won everything last night, even the very solid play, and I picked this one specifically for my mate Lee for a few reasons. Every player touches the ball. It ends up with an Andrew Bogut layup, but most important, it was the second possession of the game, so my work was done early. Hit the hay, had a glass of milk, and went to bed. Draymond to Bogey for the layup, and that's what I call a very solid play.
All right, not bad.
Well done.
A strange accent, actually.
Yeah, I'm not good at an Australian accent, actually.
We had a fan sign. We had a fan sign, guys. John Schumann himself with the tiniest fan sign we've ever seen. We love it, Shoe. All right, guys, this morning we recorded the Drop podcast. We went very deep on game one of the NBA Finals, so check that out on iTunes and Google Play Music. That's it for us. Back on Sunday, 5:30 p.m. Eastern. See you then.
Looking forward to that. Thanks for joining us, folks. And remember, Trey Kirby isn't as strong as Steve Karate.
Embrace the night, people.